Morning. We want to welcome you to Green Deal Baptist Church. Good to have you here this morning. If you're able to, we're going to have our scripture reading, Psalm 113. Psalm 113 for our scripture reading this morning. Let's stand out of respect of God's word. Pastor Grant's going to come and lead us in our song, or not our song, but he could sing this. Would that be nice?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
But he won't. He'll read it.
You'd probably prefer if I didn't sing it. We're all out of tenors today for the choir, so that's what I'm working on. Psalm 113, beginning in verse 1. Praise ye the Lord. Praise, O ye servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above all the heavens. Who is like unto God, the Lord our God, who dwelleth on high, who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? He raiseth up the poor out of the dust, and lifteth the needy out of the dunghill, that he may set him with princes, even with the princes of his people. He maketh the barren woman to keep house, and to be a joyful mother of children. Praise ye the Lord. Please remain standing for our first hymn.
Amen. He lifted all of us that know him as Savior out of the dunghill. Amen. Great message in that psalm there. All right, we'll begin by singing hymn number 389. My faith has found a resting place. If that's your testimony this morning, sing it out. We'll sing the first, second, and last stanza, 389.
My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living One, His wounds for me shall plead. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. Enough for me that Jesus saved. This ends my fears and doubt. A sinful soul, I come to Him. He'll never cast me out. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. My heart is leaning on the Word, the written Word of God. Salvation by my Savior's name, salvation through His blood. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me.
You may be seated. Turn over to back a few pages to hymn number 380. 380, another great song of our confidence that we can have in our Savior. On Christ I stand.
Amen.
We'll sing all three stanzas of this hymn here. 380.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. A higher plane than I have found, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. a higher plane than I have found. On Christ the solid rock I stand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant thy feet on Christ I stand.
Amen. Good singing on that song. We'll take a few minutes to go over some highlights in our bulletin. You'll notice there's a lot of bold in your bulletin. That means to pay attention to those bold lines. Amen. It's our pleasure to have Doug Carriger and his wife Debbie with us today. They're no stranger to our church, and certainly no stranger to Carol and I. We've known them for many, many years. Good friends at our former church in Virginia. And just thankful for their ministry, for their love for people. You can see it. You can hear it when he talks. You can see it in the ministry that God has called them to. He just loves people, loves to see them saved, and loves to help, just be a help to people. And that'll come out. It came out in Sunday school loud and clear, brother. And you'll hear it in a morning service as well. I do need to tell you that last night we lost our power about midnight, and Brother Doug and Deb were up on the second level. It gets warmer up there, right? You know, I sent him a message around 11 o'clock. It's cool enough. Yeah, he said good, good. And then the power went off an hour later. So he none of us slept great. Thank God for Sunday afternoon naps, amen. And then, but Doug also had issues with his son and had a sick dog at a vet over the night. So Doug didn't sleep at all, you know. and when I mentioned that to him, I bet you're tired. He says, yeah, but that's when God can really work, you know. So it's in our weakness that God is strongest, amen. So you're in for a blessing this morning's service. And I pray that God would have his way and his will in your message this morning, and that we'll be drawn closer to him and strengthened, and that lost souls, if anybody here doesn't know Christ as Savior, will be drawn to him today. And what a great day that would be for you. Okay, let's see. He'll be preaching tonight as well. So you want to come back for that? Let's see. There'll be a missions committee meeting this afternoon at 5 p.m. Monday night outreach this week has been postponed for a week because of the men and boys camp out. They'll be leaving the church tomorrow at noon. We'll be Monday through Wednesday, returning Wednesday. And so be in prayer for them as they go. As I look at their itinerary, you know, they got some fun things, but some things that, you know, could be dangerous, like shooting, canoeing. You know, people sometimes have bad adventures in those things, and just pray for their safety. Pray that that they'll have a good time of fellowship around God's word, around that campfire. You know, there's something about a camp and a campfire setting that's just intimate, and when the focus of that intimacy is the Lord Jesus, God can work through that. There'll be a teen smack this Wednesday, and then next Saturday the teens will be heading out to help with the Vacation Bible School at Manitowoc Baptist Church. They'll be there through August 6th. So be in prayer for them that God would help them to be a help to that church and their program. Pray that there'd be good attendance, good weather, and that many kids would come and hear the gospel and receive Christ as Savior and just make decisions that would help them throughout their life. July 31st will be a Mexican-themed Fifth Sunday. There is a sign-up sheet in the foyer where you can sign up what food or side you can bring. So that's next week. So we'll have a morning service, a meal on the grounds, and then an afternoon service. And I was pleased when I looked at that list, you know, that they got places for you to bring beans, rice, and meat and all this stuff. And then right at the end is the one for dessert. And praise God, there were four people that signed up for dessert, more than any other category. So you know it's going to be good. I don't know how we're going to do fried ice cream or what are those little puffy things with honey they put? No, they got the little puff things, you know. Sopapillas.
There it is.
Somehow somebody has to make some sopapillas, you know, with chocolate and all that good stuff on them. All right, enough said. All right, and the Alpha Women's Center Ride for Life will be Saturday, August 27th. Information forms and sign-up sheets are in the back in the foyer. So I think that's it for announcements. So ma'am, would you come forward at this time to receive the morning offering?
I suppose suppose we should clarify that announcement in the bulletin. Just the meal on that fifth Sunday is Mexican themed. You don't need to come to church in a sombrero and maracas and stuff. Just the meal is Mexican themed. Let's pray for our offering. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the privilege that it is to be here in your house worshiping you. I pray that you'd bless now in this time as we give back a portion of what you've provided to us. And I pray that we would do so with joyful hearts and trusting in you to continue to provide for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Joe, for that special. I want to mention we will be taking a love offering at the end of the service this morning and this evening for the Carrigers. Good to have them here with us this morning. Let's bow our heads and hearts in prayer this morning. Lord, we come to you today with grateful hearts. We're thankful for your goodness to us. We're thankful we are able to come out today and fellowship around the Word and fellowship with other believers. And Lord, even raise our voices up and give you praise. Lord, we think of our church family focus today. We think of Ryan Krenz. Pray that you'd minister to his needs, help him to be faithful to you, to grow in the grace and knowledge of you, and you'd meet his needs financially, physically, and spiritually. Then, Father, we think of our college student focus. We think of Lydia Bacharach as she's traveling. Pray that I pray that you give her safety and the team safety as they are traveling throughout different states out west, that you would just help her to continue to grow in that close walk with you. Help her in her studies when she comes back to Maranatha to do well. And you just provide for her in a special way. We're thankful we can pray for her today. Then, Father, we want to pray for our ministry focus. We're thankful for the Hearts and Hands Ladies Ministry, all that's involved with that. We're thankful for the ladies involved in that. Pray that you continue to bless them, bless this ministry, and it would be a blessing to each to come as they even open up the Word of God and study different subjects and things like that. And Lord, even the ministries they do, we're thankful for them and this ministry. Continue to use it for your honor and glory. Then, Father, we want to pray for our missionary focus. We're thankful for John and Nancy Moore at Camp Joy. Pray that you bless them, give them strength for their labor. We're thankful for Camp Joy and all that's involved in that. We're thankful for the many young people, many hundreds of people coming to this camp and hearing the gospel message, and even Christians hearing the message and challenge to live for you. I pray that you continue to use Camp Joy to be a great outreach for the summer months and even the retreats that they host. And we're just thankful for that. Bless and encourage John and Nancy. Give them strength as they serve you there. Then, Father, we want to pray for one of the Wisconsin Fellowship of Baptist Churches. We think of Manitowoc Baptist up in Manitowoc. I pray that you bless and encourage them. Pray that the gospel would go forth in the preaching, and Lord, they would be a lighthouse in that community. We thank you for the privilege for our teens to go up there and serve you with Vacation Bible School. Pray that it'll be a wonderful week, and as many kids come, I pray that there would even be young people getting saved and even be able to get in and reach into the homes, sharing the gospel with the families. Lord, we're thankful for the opportunity to serve you today. We pray that your blessing would be upon the preaching of the service this morning, that you'd bless our choirs that sings now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Precious truths in that hymn. At the point that we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, our name is written not only in his heart, but in the Lamb's Book of Life, never to be blotted out. Amen. Praise God for the security we have in Christ. Amen? Amen. All right, let's see. Our final song would be along that same theme, Blessed Assurance. Join me standing as we sing 381. Sing all three stanzas of Blessed Assurance. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest, I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, I'm praising my Savior all the day long.
Thank you. May be seated.
And shadow is breaking, that Jesus will come in the fullness of glory to receive from the Word his own. O Lord Jesus, how long ere we shout the glad song, Christ returneth, alleluia, alleluia, amen, alleluia, amen. It may be at midday, it may be at twilight, it may be perchance that the blackness of midnight will burst into light in the blaze of his glory when Jesus receives his own. Oh, joy, oh, delight.
Sorry, give us a run intro.
Oh, joy, oh, delight, should we go without dying? No sickness, no sadness, no dread, and no crying. Caught up through the clouds with the Lord into glory when Jesus receives his own. Oh, Lord Jesus, how long, ere we shout the glad song, Christ returneth, alleluia, alleluia, amen, alleluia, amen.
Amen. Thank you, men, for that special. I look forward to that day, don't you? Lord's return. It would be even great if he came before you started preaching. But it is good to have the Carrigers with us. They're no strangers to our church. Want to dismiss the kids, the little kids at this time. There goes a bunch of them. There goes your main audience right there, brother. We appreciate the workers involved with the junior church, and it's a privilege to have Brother Doug with us and Debbie. They're good friends of ours. Brother Doug, come and preach to us. Thank you.
You know, I appreciated the song service this morning. It was very good. Thank you for that. You know, I know sometimes you prepare for music and everybody always wonders, how's that going? And did it go okay? It blessed my heart this morning. I liked all the songs. I appreciate that. Thank you. And, you know, it's been a long time since I've heard a couple of those songs. I'm thankful for that. It's been a while. So thank you. Debbie and I are thrilled to be here again. And your pastor is always so gracious to let us swing through here on our way to a camp or something. So we always figure out somewhere in the spring that we're going to be coming through, and how many Sundays we'll find ourselves in Wisconsin and at Camp Joy. And then we always give your pastor a call. And most of the time he's able to accommodate us. There was a time where there was one brother cutting in front of me. So I had to speed that up a little bit, but he doesn't come anymore. So that worked out all right for me. But thank you. I want to preach out of the book of Revelation. You know what really pulled at my heart this morning? We're going to be in chapter 4 and 5 today. But what really pulled at my heart this morning is I read chapters 1 through 5, knowing I was preaching in 4 and 5, and a little bit of 6, because there's a lot of 6 with the judgment and things like that going on. We're not going to make it that far today. But as I read chapter 1, something really struck me today. So we know that John is taken up to heaven. It's a real thing. He's there. Talks about the Lord. Did I block that?
Is this on?
Yeah, see, it's on. Praise God. Again, we talked about that hypervigilance and that ADHD. I always got to check things like that. And, but you know what struck me this morning is it talked about the only man-made thing in heaven, and that are the marks on our Lord's hands and feet. And boy, isn't that going to be hard? I don't think of that often. You know, and this morning as I was looking at the book of Revelation and we were going through it, or I was going through it, I came across that idea, the only man-made thing in heaven is what we did to our Lord and Savior. And we were all part of that. You know, because of our sin, we're all kind of complicit in the murder of Christ and the crucifixion of Christ. When we realize we're part of that, even though we came along a couple thousand years later, we were still part of that because we get to benefit from the salvation that was obtained or attained at that level where Jesus died on that cross. So I'm always blown away. It always, for a moment there, it always kind of makes me stop and think, and it kind of makes you want to cry as a Christian when you see that this man-made Pearsons are going to be in our Lord's hands and feet, and we're going to see him. And I believe we're going to know who our Lord is. I'm not sure if he's going to look like anything like these pictures we see. Every once in a while, you know, some Pentecostal girl or something will have a vision and draw the new Lord out there. They'll put it out on Facebook. You know, we saw this as the Lord, and I'm going to freak out if one looks like me or something. But I know we were created in God's image. But I wonder who of us was created the closest in God's image. You ever think about that? We could get up there and see David Sevier as God. Wouldn't that mess you up? I'm God. David's over there. I don't know. But anyway, we come across the book of Revelation, and we know in chapter 4, we know that John's already in heaven. There's some stuff going on. He's been writing about it, talking about what's going on in the Bible. And when we get to chapter 4, he comes to a door. So there's another door in heaven. And I'm so glad that the Lord allowed the apostle to open that door. I'm so glad that we get a view of what's going on in Revelation 4 and 5. There was a time in our life, I think, that there was a message preached at church. There was during my Bible study, during my Bible reading last year. All those things in Revelation 4 and 5, Pastor Tony Miller, our former pastor at our church, was talking about prayer. And I asked him one day, I said, Pastor Miller, when we were doing the podcast, he fills in once in a while for Mrs. Wesco. And I said, brother, I said, what do you do to prepare for a prayer, to prepare to really worship God in prayer? We remember that our goal, a whole reality of serving God, is that we bring honor and glory to him. Everything we do it with the goal of bringing honor and glory to God. You know, the music we do, we don't do that for God, but we do it for the honor and glory of God. It all comes together. We go on visitation. We invite people to VBS. We reach out to the community, work with the pregnancy center. I'm always thrilled when people work with the pregnancy center and that we have other alternatives there for things that ladies are going through out there. But we do that all for the glory of God. And I submit to you this morning, I want to preach a message entitled, He is Worthy. And I think we're going to see that in Revelation 4 and 5 this morning, that we serve a worthy God. He alone is worthy. He is worthy of our praise. He deserves our glory and our honor. He deserves our worship. He deserves the best that we have to offer. And He deserves the first fruits, not the last fruits, not the, well, I think I'm going to try to go. He deserves all that we have for Him. And we'll see why, I think, as we look through the book of Revelation chapter 4, starting out there. And it says in chapter number 4, and I guess we can stand in honor of God's word for the first two verses, and then we'll sit down and I'll keep reading. There'll be a lot of Bible reading this morning. If you can stand, if you can't, just stand with your heart. That's totally understandable. The Word of God says this morning here in chapter 4 of the book of Revelation, it says, after this I looked and behold, and this is John, the Apostle John talking here, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. Heavenly Father, O Lord, we come to you this morning, and we ask that you would allow us into that throne room. O God, we beg you, if there's one here who's not saved, O Lord, you alone can save. You alone can help these people today. And we beg you, Lord, if one is not saved, God, that you would save them, and we'd be quick to give you the honor and glory. You alone save. And Lord, we think that in a group this large, there are some that are hurting today. There are struggles, there are feelings and emotions. And God, this devil wants to ruin our ministries, ruin our pastors, ruin our churches, ruin our families. And God, we pray that your word would help us today and show us how worthy you are and help us to get through these hard things we're suffering from. Dear God, I know that you alone can touch us. And I pray, Lord, if someone needs to be touched, to do that. Help us, Lord, to learn from your word. Illuminate these things. We love you. In Christ's name, amen. Please be seated. And I'm always amazed here. He says, after this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as if it were a trumpet. Now, the first time you get there in chapter 4 of the book of Revelation, what comes to your mind is the Lord's going to come back with a trumpet and a shout, right? And or shouting a trumpet. You know, I always think, is that trump going to be his voice? And when we get to chapter 4, it certainly could be, can it? The Lord's voice can be that of a trumpet, can be that beautiful, that on note, that on key. And it's so good that John's pointing out, it's like a trumpet. I mean, this is a big deal. This isn't a voice that you get around here on earth. You know, some people have wonderful voices and do things, but I think the Lord is reminding us this morning that He alone has control, talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on that throne, and that one is Jesus Christ. And as we go, it just gets more majestic and beautiful. And I was trying to find a way the last couple days to cut out some of these verses, and you just can't. You just can't take any of this away, so you know what the throne looks like and you know what's going on here. And it says in verse 3, and he that sat was to look upon like a jasper, and what a beautiful color jasper is, what a beautiful bright red and sardine stone. And here's these bright colors, and there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like onto an emerald. Colors everywhere. We see these rainbow colors and the beauty that's there by the throne of God. And can I tell you, the rainbow belonged to God long before anyone else. And that rainbow is of God. And you ever see a rainbow up close? And Debbie and I were in Hawaii and we were seeing double rainbows. We were coming from the room, and that's why they call it the rainbow state. And how beautiful, you can't differentiate the colors there. It's so magic. It's so wonderful. I remember years ago when we bought our first Mac computer, one of the selling points is spending twice as much money and paying twice as long was the idea that the color card was just so magnificent that you could Yeah, you could see things. I remember the guy at the Apple store is like, what do you use for a computer now, sir? And I'm like, I got a Toshiba. I got it at the PX for $299. He's, oh, sir, you don't know what color is. He said, sir, he said, maybe you're seeing 200 different colors on that computer. He says, that's criminal. He says, we're going to have 100 or two times as much as that. I told him, wait till the colors you're going to see in heaven if you go there. It's infinite how far that will go and those colors. And that's what's in the room. And the colors are important because God is in charge of colors. God is in charge of rainbows. God can go give us these things with our eyes that are so wonderful and so perfect and so special and so spectacular. And he that set was to look upon like a jasper. And I mean, over and over again, you can read those colors. Sardine stone, like a rainbow, an emerald, that beautiful green. And then around about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seat I saw 24 elders sitting clothed and in white raiment, and they had on the head crowns of gold. Now we will not get into who that 24 are, but you'll see there's a progression going on throughout 4 and 5 with these elders. They come in, they're in a state of worship, and there they are around the throne, and they're sitting there, and they're wearing these white garments, and everything else around them is all colorful. Everything else around them is all beautiful. Everything else around them is all majestic. And here these elders are sitting there, and they're pure white, and they're sitting in their seats, and out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were 7 lamps of fire. Remember this when you start the book of Revelation, it was to the 7 churches there in Asia, and there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were 4 beasts full of eyes before them. And he's going on. And John is just so moved by this. It's so spectacular that he's doing the greatest job he can in explanation. I don't know about you, but this is not only a book to read. These are not only words. In my mind, there's pictures going on. I'm seeing these 24 seats out there. I'm seeing them there in white. I'm seeing the Lord with his colors and the rainbow and the emeralds and these beautiful bright things that we can't replicate here on earth. There's nothing at earth that is more glorifying, more satisfying, more wonderful than what 1 second in heaven will bring any one of us. I did a study on heaven with Randy Elkhorn's book, and it changed my life. People are always saying, well, will I be married in heaven? Will I have my... Those are all great questions. We're all going to know each other, and I'm certain we're all going to be hanging together and being together and things like that. But we got to be reminded there's nothing on earth that's as awesome as heaven is. Can you imagine those relationships found up there and reborn? You know, those people you were maybe in Bible college with, maybe people who moved away, maybe people who don't like you anymore that are saved, and you're going to go on. Everybody's going to be cool in heaven. Isn't that going to be great? You know, those people who don't. I run 50-50. People either hate me or dig me. That's where I'm at. But the other 50%, I'm going to run into them up there, man. We're going to be having a good time around all those colors, around all those things. There's going to be great things happening. We're going to forget about the world, and it's going to become about he who sits on that throne. It's going to become about Jesus. It's going to be about the one that can save us. It's going to be about the God of color. It's going to be about the God of light, the God of thunder, the God speaking, who speaks with a voice with a trumpet. And we're just getting going. And then we end that last verse we just finished, and there were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. You know, I don't know about you, the first time I read Revelation, I'm like, beast with eyes. Well, we get a better picture of them too. And the first beast was like a lion. Wow. Wait, there's the Lion of Judah. Man, I like that. It's like, I've always liked lions. I don't want to be around them. I don't want to hang out with them. But man, to know that our God is like a lion, one of the strongest, greatest of all the animal kingdom. And the second beast like a calf. And the third beast had a face of a man. And the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And boy, we could do a whole sermon on what those beasts mean and who they are and how they come about. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about them, and they were full of eyes within. And they rest not day or night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. We believe, as in Ezekiel 10 or Isaiah 6, that these things are like as of angels, or like cherubim, and we're seeing, and their job is day and night, constant, over and over and over again, saying, holy, holy, holy. Has there been a time in our life today or recently where we've went holy, holy, holy to God? You alone are holy. I always love these people come up to me and tell me they're more holy than other people. And, you know, I've never had anybody, and we got to be very humble. And I say this with all humility and scared and with intrepidation. But I can't tell you how many people in my ministry came up to me and said, oh, Doug, I can't hang out with those people and stuff. They're not holy enough. They're not this. All those people who told me that are gone. I don't know where they are today. But boy, I want to be holy. But I don't get to judge my holiness. I serve a God who He alone is holy. And I try to hop on for the ride. And we do things. People say, well, why do we do this? Why do we try to live a life that's holy? Why? Because our God is holy. We don't do this so that we can be better, so that we can pump someone else out and say, look at how holy I am. Look at this way I dress. Look at the way my hair is cut. Look at what I do. We don't do that because it in some way it makes us look better. No, we do that because it's for God. Everything we do, it should be for the glory of God. We should stop and say, does this equal the glory of God? Is this something that equals being at His throne? Is this equaling the beast, the cherubim, going around Him over and over again saying, holy, holy, holy. God alone deserves that 24 hours a day. God alone deserves that type of worship. And we should give it to Him as well. And then it says, and when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to Him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever. And then it says, now look at the progression here. And we're just getting ready. I got some points here in chapter 5, I promise. But I want you to see the setting of where we should be when we go to worship God. I want you to see the setting of where we should be when we pray to God. I want you to see the setting where we as a church get together and have men's prayer group or ladies' prayer group or family prayer group, that our hearts need to be like this. This is the place that we're trying to get to. This is the place that we want our hearts to be. And in the 24 elders, so they're in their chairs, they're in their white, and they fall down before Him, sat on the throne, and worship Him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne. So I want to stop there. I know there's another word in that verse, but you know, we're out and we get some crowns, don't we? We try to, not for us, we get to go to heaven, any crowns that we earn. And I was telling Stephanie's little girl, those of you who remember Stephanie Wesco, and they have dentist appointment. They usually tag along with me everywhere I go. And they said to say hi to you. They're not making any of the, well, they're making next week's church, but then out of the three, they're only making one. But little Emmy and I were talking about her dad. And she said, Uncle Doug, do you know that Daddy has a crown, a martyr's crown? Amen. I said, boy, he earned that martyr's crown. And I said, you know what he did with that, Emmy? And she said, what, Uncle Doug? And she's 6 years old now, but she's so serious. And she said, what, Uncle Doug? And I said, he laid that down at the feet of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he gave it to Him and said, holy, holy, holy. Amen. Folks, thou art worthy. He alone is worthy. Amen. These crowns we earn, they're not so we can brag about ourselves. We're very careful. We just had the greatest month of salvations, or 2 months of salvations we've ever had in our ministry. We had over 500 people saved over there in Europe with these refugees coming out of Ukraine. For some reason, God allowed us to translate our book. I was deciding between Spanish and Russian, and God put it on my heart 2 years ago. We had enough money to do one of those languages, and God put it on my heart that we should do Russian. I never knew why. And then the war in Ukraine happened. They've already printed 32,000 copies of that book. So they're making slides. We're doing a slideshow. There's a guy over there. I'll tell you a little bit more about him. His name is Daniel Bardwell, a missionary with his family. He said, we're not leaving. They bombed the house next to him, the house in front of him, the railroad tracks behind him. They bombed 60 feet in front of his car. And he said, man, they're missing my house. He said, God's protecting me. He says, we got a ministry to go on over there. And He's holy. He alone. He is worthy. And so they fall down before Him and they sit on their throne and worship Him that liveth forever and ever in verse 10. And they cast their crowns before the throne saying, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. So why are we here? As we go into chapter 5, I think the answer is real here. As we go into chapter 5, why are we here? What is this all about? It's to bring glory and honor to God. You know, folks, if we can somehow take everything we do and throw it through that type of lens, I think we see in chapter 4, and I don't see enough of this, and I've been amazed by this. That's why over and over again, as people preached this and people went through this and talked about this over a month period in my life, I said, I need to get to be part of this. This is why I'm living my life, is to bring honor and glory to God. This is what it's all about. I'm in the ministry. I'm a worker. And if I'm not bringing glory and honor to God, I need to go home. Sometimes things don't work out exactly the way we want. I would like nothing better than to go to this VA hospital here in Milwaukee tomorrow morning, have them open every door and get to share the gospel with every one of them. But there's only certain doors that open. But when those doors of opportunity open, my friends, jump through them. They don't open an awful lot, but when God opens a door, jump through it. Point number one, I wanted to share three quick points with you. Point number one, I want to share with you out of what we just read. The glory of the Lord is worth all praise. I think we see that there in verse number 11, and actually in all of chapter 4. Now, God, He is worthy, what I mentioned about this message this morning. He alone is worthy. You know, sometimes we can get hooked up and we wonder, is this person doing all they can do? Am I doing all I can do? Is this person? We've got to stop that and say, is everything I'm doing bringing honor? Is it bringing glory and honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? And you know what? If it is, God lets you to bring other people along with you. Start picking up people for church and taking them with you. We spent a career in the Army. We tried to be servants at every church we're in. We always picked up people. We always did things like that. You know, He alone is worthy. He alone is great, and He alone can do these things. So I think it's really important. The glory of the Lord is worthy of all praise. And as we transition now with that point into chapter 5, we're going to see a lot of things going on, and we're going to feel a lot of things here, I think. And it says, and I saw at the right hand of Him that sat on the throne, being Christ, a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And we could get into those different seals and what they mean. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open this book and to loose the seals thereof? I believe that book contains all the sins of the world. This is not the book of life. This is the bad book. And who is worthy? You see, there's a price that's going to be paid on these things that are happening in the world and these different things going on. And I think you're going to see that. And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look therein. And look at verse number 4. And this is the apostle. This is what he said. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and read the book, neither to look therein. You see, there's awful things that go on in this world. There's terrible things that will be answered for. There's a time when that book's going to be open. There's terrible things we've seen. Isn't there terrible things going on? I remember the Wesco children. We try to stay with them every 3 or 4 months, 5 months. We go out there and stay in the basement. Their basement was flooded, man. They just had it fixed up. It's like going to a Hotel 8 now, except there's no doors. You know, yeah. She just tells the kids, you can't go down until at least 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. You know, and but Emmy's the only one who doesn't follow that, the little girl. She'll come about halfway down the stairs and she'll go, Unky Doug. She calls me Uncle Doug most of the time, but when she wants something, Unky Doug, are you and Aunt Debbie awake yet? And I'll go, no, Emmy. Yes, you are. You're talking to me. This family, 3 years, there's a price to be paid. Went to over 100 churches. They drove around in a motorhome with 8 kids. Stephanie fell down and broke her wrist. There were family members that hated them. There were things that went bad. Being in the ministry can be really ugly. I'm going to let you in on that. If you're called into ministry, if you can do anything else at all, you got to do that. You know, because being in the ministry is not a day in the park. And they went through all that and finally raised the money to go out to Cameroon. They finally got to Cameroon. They sold their house. Every single article in it, they gave away to people in churches and stuff. Gave away their dog. Gave away their turtle. Gave away their books. Gave away everything. They loaded a container, paid for themselves out of that money. They took all their money. They got to Cameroon. While they were there, they set up house. They went out and bought wheat grinders and all those different things. And they were making bread and additional gluten for the people there in Africa. And they were lining up to get that bread. And they were sharing the gospel. And their entire lives were consumed. And all that just to go there to be able to share the gospel with the people in Cameroon. And they were focused on that. And 12 days after they got there, they woke up one morning and said, we need more grain. We need to grind more wheat. They decided to go shopping in a city about 35 miles away. And they hopped in the car that day, and they have turns. When you have eight kids, you have turns on which kid gets to go. And that day was supposed to be Hudson's turn and Samuel's turn. And Hudson's turn, yeah. And the Lord said, no, take Charles with you, Charles Jr., the second oldest son. And he hopped in the car with his dad and his mom and another missionary, and they took off to get enough supplies to make bread for the whole community so that they could come out and share the gospel with them. And a man standing just a few feet from the car blew that husband's head to pieces and ruined the lives of the Wescos. And Stephanie threw her husband underneath her son underneath him, put her husband's head back together while his brainstem kept him alive for an hour and a half while they looked for a hospital with electricity. And then people tried to kill them leaving that part of the world. There's a price to be paid. Can I tell you that sweet little family? Some of you may not have heard Emmy's sweet song, My Father Went to Heaven When I Was Only Two. I know that Jesus loves me. I know he loves you too. Emmy was working so hard, she'd say, Uncle Doug, why did God take my daddy? I don't remember my daddy. He's going to be so mad at me. I'm going to see him in heaven and I'm not going to know who he is. And I said, Emmy, you're going to know who he is. The Bible says we're going to know each other. It's okay. And she said, well, what would daddy say to me? So we wrote a song, What Would Daddy Say If He Were Here Today? I love you so much, Emmy. I'm saying, there's a price to pay. In Ukraine right now, my friend Dan Bardwell called me up and he said, Brother Doug, I have PTSD. He made this public. He wrote in his prayer letter. He started calling me up at 4 o'clock in the morning, his time when the bombing would end or start. And he'd call me up and he'd say, Brother Doug, they just bombed the house next to me. 16 people died. When the bombing starts, everybody runs down in the subway stations and hides. He's in Lviv over there. And he runs out there, hops in his van, and he films it. He takes a box of tracks that churches like you send him and in Russian. And he runs down to the train station. And he stands at the top of the station saying, you need to read this. We could get bombed at any point. There's a price that's going to pay. He stood in line at that train station and saw four or five kids and a husband and wife killed. And he still stood at the top of the stairs and passed out those tracts. And one of the mayor of the city came to him and said, who's your God that lets you stand there at the top of the tracts where bombs are going off? He said, the true and living God. You know, John got there, folks, and he wept much because John had been there. He had been boiled in oil. He had been lied about. He had been mocked. People tried to kill him. He saw murders. He saw his Lord and Savior crucified, and he wept much when the book was opened. You know what our problem is? We're not weeping. Folks, we're not going to God and realizing what's going on around here. John wept much. He was dealing with that, and he said, none of us are worthy of this thing. We can't even open this thing up. We can't open the seals. None of us deserve to be even in the presence of Jesus Christ. And because there's a price that needs to be paid, there's things that are going to happen. And it says, and one of the elders saith unto him in verse number 5, weep not, behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and loose the seven seals thereof. There's one that can open that book. You know what he said to John? He said, behold that. He can open it. Stop weeping. It's okay. He's going to open it. He's going to see that these things are all right. And behold, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb, as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth unto all the earth. These seven spirits of God said, behold. I remember when I read this, the lamb that was slain, I had to stop and realize he was standing. He wasn't defeated. No, he's a warrior God. He's a great God. He alone is standing there in the midst of these things. He's standing upright. And I think point number 2 makes a lot of sense here. I think the glory of the Lord is being neglected by those he saved most. I think we neglect the glory of God. I think there's times in our life, and folks, I'm not picking at you. Anything I'm saying is bouncing off of me. As I read this again last night, I said, how often do I neglect the glory and honor of God? How often do I not sit down and say, God, you are holy? How often are my prayers a laundry list of needs? How often do I go to God and don't even bring up the words, you are holy, you are worthy, you alone are who I pray to, you alone can hear these things? How often do I do that? And the truth is, I don't. He alone is worthy. And point number two, I believe the glory of the Lord is being neglected by those he's helped most right now. I believe that. I believe we should be given glory and honor to him. And that who was slain, he can open the book. That who was slain was standing. That lamb who was slain was right there. Our God is standing. Our God is true. For many years, I was born and raised in religion and in ritual. For many years, I would walk up to a crucifix and see our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ hanging on that. Can I tell you, our Lord is not hanging on the cross today. Can I tell you, he's not on that cross. He's at the right hand of the Father. He alone is an intercessor for you. We should be giving him glory and honor. We should do everything possible to be able to serve him. We should do everything possible to want to be like him. And it says in that next verse, I think where we find point number three, it says, and he came and took the book out of the right hand that sat upon that throne. And I think the glory of the Lord should be most cherished and paid forward by those closest to and blessed by the Lord. If anybody should be given glory and honor to God, it should be us. You know, I'm amazed as I've been talking to people from Ukraine, and they're in Estonia now, and they're in Poland, and they're in different... Estonia wants to attack Russia. People are amazed that this war is going on, but it's not a real war because the people in Ukraine can't shoot any weapons outside of Ukraine, or the U.S. and all the other countries will stop all the help and supply for them. So there can be 30,000 Russians getting ready to cross the border, and they can sit 15 feet across the border, and by the rules of this war, they can't even blow them people up. They have to wait till they cross over in their little groups, and they try to keep up with them. They cross over in the middle of the night, and they bomb people. But you know what? And there's people over there worshiping and giving glory to God, and they don't even know God. They're out there with their special robes bringing glory and honor. They're standing on those lines looking at these Russian soldiers. And they don't even know Jesus Christ is their Lord and Savior. You know, folks, if anybody should be giving glory and honor to God, if anybody should be taking time out of their day to pray, if anybody should be taking time out of their day to worship, if anybody should be excited about worshiping God, it should be those who have been paid forward, and we should pay it forward to closest and be blessed by the Lord. And look at that next verse, verse number 8. And when he was taken the book and the four beasts and the 24 elders, they fell down. The progression continues. Remember, they were sitting there, and as their worship went down, they got down on their knees, and then they reached the point where they realized the great God they were serving, and here they are, and it said the 24 elders, the 24 elders, they fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. Wow. Who's the saints? We are. Who's bringing glory and honor to God? It should be us. Who should be praying and seeking to bring honor and glory to God and have our prayers heard? It should be us. And we're showing up on the scene. Now it was just the elders. It was John. It was the Lord. It was the elders. And then we get there, our prayers. And they sung a new song saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou was slain and has redeemed us to God, thy blood out of every kindred and every tongue and every people and every nation. And you've saved us. You made it possible for everybody in this entire world to be saved. You made it possible for these people in Ukraine being bombed right now to be saved. You made it possible for the people doing the bombing to be saved. You made it possible for people in Africa to be saved. Why do we send out missionaries? Why are there pictures on the wall? Why do we give the Faith Promise missions? Why is it we do the things we do? To bring honor and glory to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we do that through these things. We do that by following his commands. We do that, and here we are. And these folks, we should be like these 24 elders. Our worship, our praying time should have progression. We should get to the point where we fall down in front of his throne. And we should get to the point where we have that prayer room. And the glory of the Lord should be most cherished and paid forward by those closest and blessed by the Lord. That's us. And verse 10, and has made us unto God kings and priests, that we shall reign on the earth. And beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beast of the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing, and every creature which was in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and such are in the sea, and all that are being in them heard, I say, in blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and the Lamb forever and ever. And the four beasts said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him that liveth forever and ever. Did you see the progression here? These elders were sitting. They got down on their knees. They cast their crowns on there. They fell down and worshiped him. Then they had a new song. And they had the prayers and the ointments and the stuff from us, the saints here on earth. And they sang that new song and stuff, and they got to him. And when they got to the end of that, that wasn't something that was terminal. That wasn't the finish. That song of worship was a beginning. And they fell down again because he alone is worthy. Amen. He is worthy. This morning, he is worthy. I'm going to end with a quick story. And I didn't want to overload you with verses, but there were no way out. In the 1700 Europe, there was a population of Christians known as the Moravians. The Moravians were serious Christians. It seems like they sent out more missionaries than anybody in the 1700s. They wanted to reach areas and colonies and things of that nature that weren't being reached. And a slave escaped St. Croix and St. Thomas Islands, what we call the Virgin Islands today. A slave escaped from there. The entire islands were nothing but slaves. And there wasn't one Christian among them. And a slave escaped and he got back to Europe and he was telling people, there's 3,000 just on St. Thomas and not one of them are Christians. As a matter of fact, the slave leader is agnostic. Not one of them know the Lord. And we got to do something about that. And a couple men came along with German names. They found themselves in England and they decided it was time to be missionaries to the slaves on St. Thomas in St. Croix Islands. The only way you could be a missionary there is to put yourself into slavery. And you say, why in the world would anybody put themselves onto slavery? Because he alone is worthy. And they loaded on a boat and they went there, and this terrible thing happened. When they got there, they said, because you come from England, you guys can't be slaves. You have to go back. But they saw the terribleness going on and the people dying and that Christ wasn't being proclaimed. And they went back and they ended up getting five people that went along with them. And all five people put their luggage and put their belongings in caskets because they said, we're going to need them over there. And they ended up where the queen rented a boat from a different part from the Dutch boat. And they brought them in to be slaves and they showed up and they committed themselves to slavery. And as they showed up, they shared the gospel and did whatever they can. And we could look up history today with the Moravians. But out of the first 20 slaves that made it to St. Croix and St. Thomas, and people kept on going. And out of those first 20 slaves, 19 died within their first 6 months. Do you realize that slavery started going away in those islands in the 1800s? That people would leave there and say, those were the most Christian places I've ever traveled to. The slaves didn't have to be restrained. People were having church meetings, singing hymns in the field. And you say, well, Brother Doug, what does this all have to do with me? He is worthy. You may not have to sell yourself into slavery, but there's things right here in Milwaukee, doors that you can walk in. There's people that are going through equally terrible times. There's people whose lives are upside down. And you can be part of that. Is he worthy? Is he that worthy to you this morning? Maybe some of you are here this morning. I need to ask you the question. There's four things you need to know to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. First thing you need to know, you know what the Bible says, number one? We're all sinners. The Bible says there are none righteous, no, not one. Can you imagine that? Every single one of us upon earth, every single one of us here today are sinners. We're all sinners. We're all sinners. First thing you need to know to be saved is you're a sinner. Second thing you need to know is there's a price on sin. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. So if we're going to be understanding that Jesus Christ is worthy and we're going to want to serve him, we first have to enlist like we talked about in Sunday school. So you got to know you're a sinner. There's a price on sin and that price is death. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. But here's the great news. The Bible says, but God commendeth his love toward us. Everybody in this room, God freely gave his love to you. But God commendeth his love toward us. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Number one, we're sinners. That's bad news. But we know that, don't we? Even after we save, we still know we're sinners and that there's some things we have to make sure we don't do. Number two, there's a price on sin, and that price of sin is death. Number three, Jesus paid that price. Amen. Folks, let me tell you something. That's some pretty wonderful news. But number four talks about an enlistment, actually doing something with that. We can know those first three things. We can walk around and know those first three things. We can live a life where we know that Jesus died for our sins. We know that we're sinners. We know there's a price on sin and still go to hell. Because the Bible says we must speak it with our mouth and believe it with our heart. So there's a time, as it says over there in Romans 10, 9 and 10, and it says our heart speaketh unto righteousness. And later on in verse 10, it talks about in salvation. I don't know about you, but that's pretty wonderful news. So I want to ask you a question this morning. Would you stand with me? Your head's bowed and your eyes are closed and there's nobody looking around. I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to get out of pastor's way. Just a couple quick questions and a prayer. But if you're here this morning, do you remember a time that, number one, you realized you were a sinner?